Welcome, all of you, to Table at 45 Rock. I'm Chris Kevorkian. My partner in crime in this digital dinner series endeavor is the wonderful Peggy Northrup, who's the worldwide editorial director of Reader's Digest. She and I have collaborated to create what we sort of, you know, cheekily call a salon, where once a month we get 25 of the leading people in our industry who are sort of enjoying both the agony and the ecstasy of designing for the various digital platforms, personal mobile devices. We get them together and we talk about what's working, what's not working. We have found that plying them with some alcohol for about a half hour beforehand makes for more sharing and more lively dialogue. So we've been backstage drinking. Just so that we could replicate the whole experience for you. As representative attendees of our prior events, I have brought together, from my left, Sam Syed, Creative Director, Popular Science from Bonnier, Pam McCarthy, the Deputy, we asked her where her star was, but the Deputy Editor, New Yorker, Condé Nast. We're also joined by Jason Revzon, SVP Interactive from the Tauton Press. Dana Points has also been kind enough to join us from Parents and American Baby, the Meredith Corporation, where she is the editor. And Jim Meigs brings up the end there. The editor, and he was at the end because he's got the longest title. Jim Meigs, editor-in-chief, Popular Mechanics, editorial director, Hearst Men's Enthusiast Group, Hearst Magazines. Pretty good, huh? So to sort of set the stage on the ecstasy part, we'd like to roll a little video that sort of is a celebration of what all of these folks and their peers have been able to accomplish in the last 12 to 16 months. So roll tape. So the good news is, with those opportunities to create content and curate content with sight, sound, and motion, we have the ability to extend magazine media in a way we've never had before. So that's the good news. The challenging part of it is that, in most cases, with the same staff and the same resources, these folks are now challenged with creating, developing, and curating content for their anchor brands in a variety of new platforms, whether it's tablet, e-reader, or smartphone, and whether it's a monthly or a weekly. God help the folks with the weeklies. Jim, the man with the longest title in town, would you talk about your experience? Because you were in a lovely position of being someone who was asked to dabble in this early on, and you had a very long runway. How did you approach it? What have you learned, and what are you doing now that the rest of us should be doing?
Right, yeah, we are kind of proud to be sort of the skunk works for playing around with new platforms at Hearst. And so we were experimenting with putting magazine content on tablets about a year and a half before the iPad came out, working with some e-ink devices. It wasn't a very satisfying experience. So when we got our hands on the iPad, it was a whole world opened up. So two main lessons. The first one is to tear down the wall between editors and coders. Don't think you can take your magazine, hand it to a digital team, and say, oh, here, take this away and convert it to digital. Because you're building a new user interface. You're creating not just the look and feel of the content, but how the user is going to interact with it. Incredible opportunities. So we have our programmers, our editors, our designers all sitting together on the same floor, working together. They push each other and challenge each other in ways that no single group could do by themselves. And what we've learned in here is don't underestimate how the skill set of traditional print people is actually very, very well suited to this environment. Unless you want your tablets to look like websites, it's really important to have that dialogue between people from the print background and your programmers. Of course, we programmed in-house, so that gave us an advantage. The second lesson is we have to blow up the print paradigm. For too long, we've said, okay, let's make a really great magazine article. I think Chris Anderson called it a Fabergé egg. You know, it's beautifully crafted. It's a wonderful thing. And then we'll take that and we'll tweak it a little bit for iPad, or we'll tweak it a little bit for web. Right now, we need to think like multi-platform publishers. So you have to take those decisions as far upstream as possible. When you assign the story, when you conceive the story, don't say, oh, what's going to make a perfect print story, and we'll worry about the rest later. You have to assign and budget and plan all the elements, all the assets that are going to go in to all the different platforms. So if we sign a big package, we've got certain elements for print, but at the same time we're producing the elements we're going to use for the iPad, elements for web, maybe even the eventual book or ebook that'll come out of the project at the end of the line.
Great. Sam? At Bonnier, what have you done with your team to address the workflow challenges? Because can I get a show of hands on how many of you have hired several new people to be able to develop your... Several?
A couple, yeah.
Okay, a couple. A couple is not several. But so that's one who thinks several is two, and nobody else is...
Freelance.
Okay. Yeah. So would you answer my question, what have you done at Bonnier, please?
Actually, remarkably similar to Jim. We recognized quite early on that a sequential approach to production was doomed to failure. And what we needed to do was have people working on all the different end products at the same time, which is just much better all around, leads to a better product all around, but it's the only way to make it practical. So what we did was we created a unified art department. I actually have four brands, not just Popular Science. So my little art department produces four magazines, and right now we have three iPad editions. I did hire a digital producer. I have a full-time freelancer doing two of the iPad editions. We do have to spend some resources on producing rich media components, but which we do judiciously. And that requires outside help. But essentially, it's the same volume of team members that we probably would use to produce just the print magazines, and we're producing all of it.
But by putting them in a bullpen, you've got greater efficiency.
One of the things that we did was we have a single place that where everybody sits, and just like Jim was saying, people cross-pollinate their skills. It's actually a really happy place to work, one of the very a few happy places to work that I've heard of in the industry these days. Everybody's having a good time as well as producing great material.
Good. One of the things we promised to touch upon in this panel was user interface. I mean, so we've talked about some of the design issues. So I'm going to go back to these two gentlemen on the ends, and then we'll go to the other fabulous folks in the middle. You know, there are two different points of view. One where the consumer should direct their experience. So the editor creates the content and tries to give visual cues so that that end user knows exactly what to do and when, and they're empowered. And then there's a point of view, and that tends to be more or less what Jim on that end does. And then there's a point of view that I know best, which is sort of embodied by this guy right here, that's where, you know, you swipe a page and boom, the video rolls. Because you're driving and engineering the end user experience. So I'd love you two to talk about why the other one's wrong.
I don't completely think that the other one's wrong. I think that market research is a component, a tool that we all use, but ultimately I feel that we're content creators and it's our job to think of things that the audience can't, won't, or simply doesn't think of. That's what we're here to do. I also think that storytelling components like headlines, intro paragraphs, things like that, we don't switch them on. They're part of the storytelling flow. They're the tools that we use. Just watching that film, it was actually quite clear, astonishingly clear, that video or motion is the photography of the digital era. And you don't turn photos on when you create layouts. So that's just what I think, that it's an automatic part of the storytelling process. And if it's all about people clicking on things, I do remember there was this time when people were making films where you could choose your own ending. And I don't really think that they went anywhere. And people still go to the movies and they watch the stories that people want to tell them. That's what I think.
So you're right.
I don't know.
All right, well, I would say, actually there are movies where you pick the ending. They're called video games. And it's a multi-billion dollar industry. But I don't think that's what we're building in our apps. And I think we're pretty close on this. A lot of little things that play quickly and that add to a sense of fun, animated headlines, illustrations that have a little bit of movement to them. We have that stuff play automatically. What we don't do is launch longer videos, and we leave that up to the user. But the key thing I think we've found is that video is not the heart of this. We keep hearing in our surveys, people keep saying, hey, I like the articles. They keep talking about articles, which totally surprised us. We kind of forgot that along with everything else we were doing, all the interactivity, we were putting good articles in there. And yet people do like to read. Look at the success of the Nook. Look at the success of ebooks. Good articles, good pictures are still the heart of this experience. And we augment them now with new tools. But we're already really good at producing something that readers really like. And we have to give it to them in a clean, accessible way.
Great content, great storytelling.
Can I add one thing, which is I think there's a middle ground, which is kind of what the approach that we've taken with parents, which is if it's something that, you know, I work at a service magazine. If it's something that the reader needs as a tool where she could opt into the content, fine, make her push play. But if it's something that's there purely to delight her, part of the delight, the experience of being delighted is being surprised. And so we have some things that play, you know, on a snap and others that you have to ask for.
Discovery is a key portion of the enjoyment of these kinds of materials.
We're looking for answers. We're looking for right, you know? So come on, work with me. I think Dana's got a point. But Dana, could I ask you to expand on that? Because you're in a position where your job is so much harder than these guys' jobs, because you're designing really for two audiences, and there aren't that many editors, I think, that are challenged in the way you are, where you're designing for the parent. I mean, you're creating content for the parent, but you're looking at enabling interactivity and engagement with their children. So,
yes.
I mean, that's an interesting...
We approached, I mean, our runway wasn't quite as long, but and because our audience is overwhelmingly women and moms, they were a little bit later to the party, although they're certainly there now. And we had to sort of look out at the future and say, well, is it just going to be a single user device, or is it going to be kind of a co-play device, something that's shared in the family? And we really approached our tablet edition as co-play. So there's a whole section in it that's something that you share with the child. The child can hear music, can, you know, hear a sample from a book, check out a film clip. And then only later, Meredith has done a lot of research on its tablet editions, and we have found that moms, of course, and we've all done it, many of us in person now, are handing the device off to the child and letting the child play. So it becomes sort of a little bit of a curated playroom. But we keep our primary user, which is mom, in mind.
I think that's key. I think in the beginning of the process, you really have to think hard about who you are, what your identity as a magazine is. Our mission is reading, and we decided that we wanted to create an app that was about reading. And we knew from our readers' behavior with the mobile website, with Kindle, with Nook, with our digital edition, which is really a replica edition, the web-based digital edition, we knew that they like to access our content, our magazine, the long stories, long-form reporting and criticism and fiction, to access it digitally. And they had demonstrated that they were really willing to put up with much less than perfect design and functionality to access the stories weekly. So there was no question in our mind that we would do an app. And there was no question that it was going to be about reading, that it had to be consistent with who we are. So we strove to replicate the look, not, you know, a three-column format. We didn't want it to look like a digital book. That was a real danger. We wanted it to evoke the magazine. So we used the typefaces and created a kind of very classic, simple design that was comfortable to read. But that said, we did want to make use of the technology. I think nothing would be more frustrating as a reader to feel that there were opportunities that were missed. And frankly, nothing would be more frustrating as an editor. So we decided that we would use these iPad opportunities, extras, very sparingly and quietly. We really wanted to keep the message that word was king in the magazine, but that there was more if you wanted it, if you wanted to dive deep. So we've got about 10 per issue. Writers reading their short stories, writers reading their poems, source documents. They are there. They are certainly not auto-rolling. You don't turn the page and suddenly hear a poem.
They're not intrusive.
They're not intrusive. But we spent a lot of time making sure they wouldn't be missed. You know, it's all these things are a balance.
It's a balance.
So we have icons that say, you know, here you can have more. You can have a slideshow.
Jason, you guys have taken yet a different approach. Would you share that with us?
Sort of the opposite in that we are only extras. We haven't yet put out the full edition of the magazines. We've focused more on reimagining what our relationship was with our audience or audiences. Although we publish niche magazines, we thought it was an opportunity to look at even smaller chunks of audience as opposed to sort of replicating or enhancing the magazine experience and look at their lives as cooks or as woodworkers to see what we could build for them there. So our focus really was on tools, on things that take advantage of the devices that are out there, primarily the iPad and the iPhone, and make it easier to cook Thanksgiving dinner. Make it easier to find, you know, one of 45 million brownie recipes that's right for you, or die trying. And there are, you know, a lot of different opportunities. Some of them, not so interesting. We do have a drywall application. But overall, we do know.
You don't want your brownie to be like drywall.
No, you don't. But we know our audiences, and we have a relationship with them. And I think it's a time, you know, at a lot of places to reimagine why things became a magazine in the first place.
Yeah.
You know, there are certain limitations to the distribution and to the expenses of putting it together as one editorial package at one time and distributing it to a massive audience. And it's an opportunity, maybe a fleeting opportunity, to reevaluate what that business is and how to chunk it into smaller pieces for people who really want something very specific and that you can over deliver and charge a premium for at the same time.
Great. Now we're running out of time rapidly, so we're gonna go to the lightning round, okay? Get the guy, lightning round. I'd ask these guys each two questions. One is, if you had a magic wand, what one thing would you deploy that magic wand on in terms of this whole genre? And then, what are you really worried about? You know, what's keeping you up at night? And Jim, we're gonna start with you.
Okay, number one, the purchase experience has really not been working well since the launch of this. The magazine stand, findability. The magazine stand will help this, and obviously Amazon Fire will be a huge step forward for us. Two, the thing I worry most about in disruption is Google. Their entire business model is finding other businesses to disrupt. And now that they've disrupted all the old ones, they're going to start trying to disrupt new ones.
Well said. Dana?
I would say if I could kind of see the future, I'd love to see how the reader involvement in the product will kind of escalate. We are already inviting our readers to contribute to our tablet edition, and I think it's not too far before they'll be able to contribute in real time. And so I'm really curious to see how that's going to work out. And what was the other question? Sorry.
What's keeping you up at night? That's all great.
I would say staff and resource issues. The idea that I think for a lot of us it's been about freelance people, and I've really tried to train my staff and kind of backfill the staff positions with freelance so that we don't lose, that we kind of keep the expertise native in-house. So keeping that training happening and then keeping those marketable people from going elsewhere.
Yeah, are any of you guys running into the poaching from one another yet?
Not quite yet, but we're watching.
But it's coming. It's coming. And just wait till HTML5. Jason.
Okay, two things. One, an app that would make me look better on a big screen if I had a magic wand. But the second thing really is what you just said, which is HTML5. We're just seeing the beginning of sort of the war between the proprietary systems and more of an open web approach, an HTML5 approach to delivering content that looks and acts like an app. You know, the people at Tauton have had a little foresight to start charging for essentially HTML4 content on the web, and we're going to continue to do that, you know, in the app world. But I see that there's sort of a narrow window when these standalone apps will exist before we move into something that's more open. I mean, already the biggest application on any device is the browser, and I think that should be worrying for a lot of people. It's also an opportunity.
So you're seeing a web-based future, possibly?
Yeah.
Pam?
I think that the thing that I would want to change and the thing that keeps me up at night are really one and the same, and that is the sheer number of devices. It's absolutely dizzying as an editor to try to prepare your material to really shine on each of these devices. Back in the beginning, in the dark ages a year ago, I thought I had settled on a really reasonable position. We would only do three versions for tablet or for smartphone and tablets. We would do small, we would do medium, and we would do large, and that was it. I was going to hold the line. But yeah, that was a real babe in the woods position. I seemed like an innocent.
Seems like ages ago,
you know,
right?
We're now on four devices, and each one requires tweaking to make our material work at all, let alone shine. And you know, if you think down the road to the logical next four, each of those is going to require substantial custom work for development and in an ongoing way. So I think we're all going to have to work with our publishers and management to think about which devices we're going to be on. I think it's not realistic to think that you can be on all of them. And we're going to have to make choices. Think about where our readers are going to be and what's going to scale in the end.
Do you think that's going to be a 7-inch versus 10-inch choice? You know, are you going to have to pick a tablet screen size that you commit to, and then you've got your smartphone?
I'm still willing to do small, medium, and large, but one time each.
Okay.
And I think the jury's still out. I think the Kindle Fire is going to be something of a game changer, and I think that, you know, I would have 6 months ago said 10-inch because the iPad really is succeeding in a way that it's hard to imagine other 7-inch doing, but I think this may be quite different.
Do you think it's going to be a game changer because of price point or because of the form and functionality? How many of you have had one in your hands? So we're all,
I think price point and an expectation that it's going to be good, having spoken with people who have held them now. Yeah, you know, we've heard this before about some devices. You like to imagine that they're going to be fantastic and there's going to be something that presents a real alternative to Apple. But nothing has quite done that yet, so okay. We'll see.
Sam, magic wand?
I want coders in my art department to help me make fluid, seamless content that automatically starts.
All the time?
Where necessary.
Where necessary.
Where it's an important part of the storytelling flow.
Okay. And is that you don't have those coders because of resource issues or room or people won't work for you?
They won't work for me now after this. actually, it's two problems. One is obviously money is always a problem. But the other problem is it's kind of what Jim was talking about earlier, that the old processes aren't going to work in the new era, and we need to redefine the way we do things. Process is very important, so we need to understand that the divisions, the titles that people have, all of that kind of stuff, is very much up for grabs. We're storytellers, and mm-hmm. we need people to help us with the storytelling, whether they be researchers, coders, art directors, editors, or whatever. I have a PhD astrophysicist in my art department. I have an After Effects guy in my art department. And I have designers in my art department. I'd like a coder.
Well, this is a real change for editors. It, you know, it used to be that the more technical side, the printing, was the really the only thing that you didn't do. We did everything else.
And now the more technical side, which most editors and many art people aren't trained in, are actually quite key to the material that you're creating. I mean, it can limit you, it can give you tremendous opportunity. So I want coders too.
Coders and I guess the education to go along with that for the
Absolutely.
rest of your teams,
you're right.
Right? All right, I'd like all of you to join me in giving our panelists a round of applause. I'd like to thank them all for coming to the Table at 45 Rock dinners and participating and leading the conversation. I'm Chris Kevorkian at magazine.org. It's an interesting name. But anyone who would like to be invited to a dinner, we do them monthly. Please shoot me an email and we'll put you on the list and we'll get you involved in the conversation just as soon as we can. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will now take a 15-minute break. Please use this opportunity to visit our sponsor partner tables in the foyer area. Special thanks to Adobe, who generously sponsored this break.